Welcome to another Shiur under my Maimonim of the Rebbe. This is a project which started a year and a half ago that in addition to the Maimonim of the Alter Rebbe, which we've been doing now with the great kindness of the Chanan Fund for about 7 years, of the Alter Rebbe and the Kutei Teira and Teira Eir, we're now doing also the Maimonim of the Rebbe, and we've chosen to do the edited Maimonim. And with Hashem's help, we will journey through them one at a time until we will complete them. And if we ever reach a point where we'll run out of material, the Yibishter will give us plenty to do beyond that point. But we're nowhere near scratching the surface of the amount of Maimonim that the Rebbe gave us that are edited. But we did something different this time. We're doing a Hemshech, a series of Maimonim, which is 4 or 5 Maimonim, of which only 2 are edited. And as it turns out, the 2 Maimonim we just completed, Shmini Atzeres and Bereishis, and if you recall, each Maimer, we did 4 classes, a total of 8 classes, and these 2 Maimonim, those 2 Maimonim were unedited. The Maimer we're doing now is Yitzchak Kislev, Padre B'Sholem, and Emitz Hashem, after Padre B'Sholem, we're going to have the Maimer of Shabbos Mevorchim Tevis, which is Baruch Sh'os Anisim, it's a Chanukah Maimer. These 2 Maimonim are edited, are Muga. If I needed to label, categorize, the difference between what we learned in the 2 Maimonim until now and what we're about to do with this Maimer, I would put it this way. In the first 2 Maimonim of the Hemshech, which were very scholarly, they were very involved, very askolidic, the Rebbe presented us with the issue of Das Elyon and Das Tachten, or Yehuda Tato and Yehuda Eloh. In other words, there's different perspectives on the relationship between Hashem and the world, and the different perspectives of the relationship between Hashem and the world are known on different levels of Das. It's not only knowing a higher thing or knowing a lower thing, it's knowing a higher thing with a higher tool called Das Elyon, and knowing a lower thing with a lower tool which is called Das Tachten. And the Maimer presented us with a whole series of form for this Yehuda Tato, Yehuda Eloh, / Das Tachten and Das Elyon. The first and most basic one, of course, was that Yehuda Tato and Das Tachten is in Nivroim, is in creation, and Yehuda Eloh and Das Elyon is in Elokus. And then we learned how you have Yehuda Tato and Das Tachten, and Yehuda Eloh and Das Elyon, that are both in Elokus. And then we learned how you have Yehuda Tato and Das Tachten and Yehuda Eloh and Das Elyon that are both in a person's Avodah, in the Nefesh of the person and in Avodas HaAdam. And more or less, this is what we covered in the last 8 Shiurim on the first 2 Maimonim with this Hemshech, which, as I mentioned a moment ago, are both unedited. What happens now is a new idea. We're not discussing Das Tachten, Das Elyon anymore. We're not discussing Yehuda Tato, Yehuda Eloh anymore. We're discussing what is called, or what is understood to mean, Yichud, Yehuda Eloh, and Yehuda Tato, to join together the 2 Yichuds, or to join together the 2 Deis. In other words, after we established in so many different ways what Yehuda Tato and Das Tachten is, and what Yehuda Eloh and Das Elyon is, in all kinds of scenarios, Nivr and Elokus, Elokus alone, Nivroim alone, we move on to another idea, that there is a third concept. In addition to Yehuda Tato and Das Tachten, and Yehuda Eloh and Das Elyon, in all the various ways we explained earlier, there's a third concept of joining the Das Tachten and Yehuda Tato with the Das Elyon and Yehuda Eloh. Like Yichud, Yehuda Eloh, and Yehuda Tato. Sometimes in my Maimonim you have that expression. Yichud, Yehuda Eloh, and Yehuda Tato. Our Maimon doesn't exactly use that expression, but it seems to me that this is the issue of our Maimon. So it's like a new step in the discussion. We've done Yehuda Tato and Das Tachten. We've done Yehuda Eloh and Das Elyon. And I want to mention that he actually discussed something which is even higher than Yehuda Eloh, and even higher than Das Elyon, which is Tachas Hayadiyah Shalei Neido Acha, as we learned at the end of the previous Maimer of Reishis. The Maimer we're currently immersing ourselves in with the help and the grace and the kindness of God is a Maimer that's going to explore not only the idea that the chude tato and das tach nichude lo and das elyon, but the need to be mishalev, to be miyache, to unify the two deis, to come up with in effect a third idea, the fusion of both. But in order to facilitate this, the Rebbe introduces us to new language. The language of this maimir, which is going to set up an understanding of yichud haton, das tachton and yichud elon, das elyon, and lead us ultimately to understanding the yichud of the two deis, is the language of nes and teva, where obviously teva would be das tachton, nature would be the lower deya, and nes, the miracle, would be the higher day. We had a maimir from the Rebbe from Tafshin Yud Beis, a mugadika, which we learned, I think it's an Achat Shapesach maimir, a difficult maimir, where the Rebbe also explored the meaning of nes and teva. Here again, the Rebbe explores the sugya of nes and teva, and it seems that the sugya of nes and teva is not that widespread in Chassidus. The Rebbe seems to be the one who's opened it up in a way which has not much precedent. The Rebbe seems to be developing the discussion of nes and teva in many, many of his maimorim, including many of the maimorim that are actually muga, edited. So the way we're doing this is as follows. We're going to learn the biur first and the maimor second. In other words, if everything goes to plan, and everybody knows what plans are worth, the plan is that we're going to have three shiurim on this maimir. The first two are going to be the biur, the middle of the maimir, the nes and teva sugya. The third one, the last one, is going to be the beginning and the end, which is the maimir itself, where the ideas of the yichud or the shilov of yichud elah and das tachten and yichud tato and das tachten and yichud elah and das elyon becomes very, very clear and understood. But you can, of course, you can't understand it without first exploring the question of teva and nes as our maimer does it. So b'li neder, u be'ezer Hashem yizbarach. We're going to have two classes. The first class is going to discuss nes and teva. The second class is going to continue that conversation in a much deeper and a much edeler way. And then the third class will do the taschola and the siyum, the end and the beginning, of the beginning and the end of the maimer, where the yichud and the shilav of the two yichudim and the yichud and the shilav of the two deis becomes understood. So the maimer begins on page lamed ches, we start on page mem. Okay? But before we start, let's state the obvious, let's preface, let's introduce teva and nes to us, to the conversation. All of Chassidus is predicated on the principle of Achdus Hashem. Chassidus is all about the idea that ein eid milvad, there's no separation between the world and HaKadosh Baruch Hu. In other words, let's speak simple first. There are many, many people who believe in Hashem that are not religious. There are people who don't believe in Hashem, Rahman al-Itzlan. There are many people who believe in the Eibish that are not religious. Now, why would a person believe in Hashem and not be religious? It's a very simple thing. You could believe in Hashem as the Bayri Elam, the Eibish that created the world, but you could construe, you could fathom, you could imagine that the Eibish that is the Bayri Elam and is not the Manega Elam. He created the world, now the world is on its own. If you have this belief system, which in the words of the Alter Rebbe in Shari'ich et Vemuna, this is connected to believing what the Pilisufi believe, that the creation is only Yesh Miyesh, Raksha Mashana Hatzura, then you can believe the Eibish that created the world and Ozav Avayah starts, it's not involved in the world. So Yiddishkeit, obviously, clearly and basically, introduces us to the concept of Achdus Hashem. Achdus Hashem does not mean that Hashem is one. Achdus Hashem means that Hashem and the world are one. Achdus Hashem is not about God, it's about the Eibish's connection to the world. And in the Lashon HaRav, that the Rebbe would repeat, the Rebbe does repeat over and over and over again, and he would say it with so much enthusiasm and so much passion, especially when he spoke to the little children. You can hear the Rebbe saying these words with such resonance, with such passion. Boirei oylam u'manhigoy. Boirei oylam u'manhigoy means that not only is the Eibishter the creator, the Eibishter is the governor and the conductor of the world. He's the manager of the world, which means It's not that he made the world. Now the world is left to its own devices. He made the world and he governs the world as he sees fit. And again, in the language of the Shara, Yichud V'Emunah, if you believe in Yesh Me'ayin and his Havas B'chol Rega, you have to believe that the Eibishter is involved. This is basic Yiddishkeit, basic Chassidus, Achdus Hashem. Now when you learn Chassidus, Shara Yichud V'Emunah, about Achdus Hashem, you go many levels of Achdus Hashem. The lowest level of Achdus Hashem is called Dvar Havayah. The Eibishter creates the world with words. And the words are hidden. Helam v'hester abeirim ha-nivra. So we perceive ourselves as creations. We don't feel the keich eliki, the words of HaKadosh Baruch which create us. And ilu nit neshus l'ayin lidus. If we would be able to see the words which are creating us, we would become a likus. That's the first achdus. Then, of course, there's a second achdus. And the second achdus in Shara, Yichud V'Emunah, is havayahu ha-likim. Havayu Elokim means that the Eibishter conceals himself. Hashem hides himself in order for the worlds to be a world. But Ein Etzem Master Al Etzem. That means to say, to us, Hashem is hidden. And to the Eibishter, he is still revealed. We just don't see him. It's like a one-way mirror. To us, the world is world. And to the Eibishter, that very same world is Elokus. And then comes the third Madrega. The third Madrega is Tzimtzum Shalei Kipshutei. Tzimtzum Shalei Kipshutei says that not only is there a Tzimtzum that's true only to us, and to Adeibishad the Tzimtzum isn't true, but to us also there's no Tzimtzum, because the Tzimtzum is Eini Kipshutei. The notion that Hashem concealed himself is not true. In reality, the Adeibishad is in the Mokam HaChol in the world, even now, just that we're not able to perceive him. So there's a number of different steps or levels and categories in Achdus Hashem. And of course, Chassidus pushes it to its extreme. When Chassidus talks about Achdus Hashem, Chassidus establishes, ultimately, there's nothing besides for the Eibishter. So if you establish there's nothing besides for the Eibishter, you know, you even have this in Tanya, the simple question. What is one of the principles, the Shara Yichud V'Emunah, right? How does the Shara Yichud V'Emunah work? Everybody knows that the Likutei Amorim, Sefer Shalbanyan, in the first section of Tanya, goes on a pasuk. What pasuk does it go on? It goes in the pasuk. Yikarev elech adavam eid b'fiach b'vavcha la'aseisei. Levayir heitev eich yikarev meid v'darach aruch uktzara. The first section of Tanya explains the pasuk yikarev. Some people are not aware, but the second chelik of Tanya also goes on a pasuk. And what is it? Levayir machkasa b'zeyar. The Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad Yichud Yilah and Baruch Shem Kaved Mechus Elei Levad Yichud Tato. That's the Keseres on top of the Pedek Aleph of Shara Yichud V'Emunah. After you have the Akdama, the Altrebbe writes in two lines in a smaller type that what's going to be discussed is to explain how the Pasuk Shema Yisrael, the Zayar says, means Yichudei Allah, and the Pasuk Baruch Shem Kaved Mechus Elei Levad, which of course is found in Medrash and in Gemara, is Yichudei Tato. Now what is the meaning of this question? What is it that the Altrebbe needs to explore? And of course the answer is, once you understand the higher achdus, does that not automatically cancel the lower achdus? In other words, what does Yichud HaTorah say? Yichud HaTorah says there's a world and Eibishter is a balabas. What does Yichud HaLoah say? That there's no world, there's only an Eibishter. Or that the Eibishter's expression of the world is such an extent that there's no metzias of world, there's only a world in as much as it expresses him. So if you have a number of different ways of understanding the relationship to the creator and the creation, on the lower level, the creator is the master of the creation. On the higher level, the creator is the truth of the creation, but he's concealed. And on the highest level, the creator and the creation are one and the same thing. Literally, the creation is the creator, except that we don't see creator. So once you have a higher achdus, the lower achdus is cancelled. And therefore, the Alter Rebbe has a kasha, lo hav mashkos b'zayar. Why would the Zayar do what our Maimer does? Speak emphatically about two yichuds, Yichud HaTato and Yichud HaYilah. And Yichud HaTato means there's a world of which Hashem masters, governs. And Yichud HaYilah means the world is nothing other than expression of Hashem, Ein Eid Mulvadeh. Isn't it true that Yichud HaYilah cancels Yichud HaTato? And in Tanya, the Alter Rebbe is wondering about this question, and it's one of the points that he addresses in a primary way in the Shara Yichud HaEmunah. And the same is true in our Maimer. If you remember the first classes I gave you, I emphasized the idea that Kel Deyas Havai, both Deyas are true. They're both in Elokus. Yichud HaTato is Emes and Yichud HaLoah is Emes. Now the simple reason they're both true is because there's two Deyas. Das Tachne can only relate to Yichud HaTato. Das Elyon can relate also to Yichud Allah. So because there's two deists, there's two Yichuds. There's the Yichud which is understood or perceived by Das Tachton, and there's a Yichud which Das Tachton cannot know and Das Elyon can know. But this is a huge philosophical Pandora's box, if you will. Once you understand the notion of Ein Eid Mulvade, what reality is there after all? You know, there's a classic story. It really is it's a simple little story, but it is a classic story. That there was a chassid of the Tzemach Tzedek who lent money to another chassid of the Tzemach Tzedek. Reuven lent money to Shimon. And when it came time for Shimon to pay, Shimon refused to pay Reuven. And the grounds for refusing to pay was Achdas Hashem. That since there's Ein Eid Mulvade, time doesn't exist, and Reuven doesn't exist, and Shimon doesn't exist, and the loan doesn't exist, and the money never changed house, so Shimon owns Reuven nothing. If Reuven doesn't exist, and Shimon doesn't exist, and time doesn't exist, and money doesn't exist, and loan don't exist, what does Shimon owe Reuven? And Reuven, it's a great joke, you know, it's fun for an afternoon, tzachus, but Shimon was very serious. Shimon meant it. Whereas, since Chassidus teaches us, Ein Eid Mulvade, I don't exist, you don't exist, money doesn't exist, I don't owe you anything. So Reuven went to the Tzemach Tzedek. And the Tzemach Tzedek summoned Shimon. And for some reason, we know one of the great miracles that happened is that even though Shimon said Ein Eid Mulvade and there's no reality, somehow the words of the Tzemach Tzedek were real enough and he actually came to Lubavitch. And he went to the Tzemach Tzedek. And Tzemach Tzedek said, is it true that you borrowed money from Reuven? He says, yeah. Is it true that the time for the debt to be paid has passed, come and gone? He said, yeah. Is it true that you haven't paid it back? He said, yeah. Is it true that you have no intentions of paying it back on the grounds of Ein Eid Mulvade? Shimon said, absolutely. So the Tzemach Tzedek said, this is how the story is told. He said, mit dem und dem gar nicht, avekleg of dem gar nicht, und reinschmeißen mit dem gar nicht, vetmezenzi alles ist gar nicht. We'll take this nothing, pointing at Shimon, at the borrower. We'll prostrate him, we'll stretch him out over dem gar nicht, this nothing, the table. We will whip him with a belt. Another garnish, and we'll see whether everything is nothing. If Ein Eid Mulvade, he's not going to scream, he's not going to shout, he's going to feel no pain. But if when you hit him, he feels pain, it's when he borrows money, he has to pay it back. Meaning to say, if to you, the world is real when it comes to yourself, the world is real when it comes to somebody else as well. But what the story illustrates is the great question of Chassidus. Once you understand Achdas Hashem on a higher level, then you can argue that the Achdas Hashem on a lower level is simply false. People who learn Chassidus, Yeshiva Bachim will learn Chassidus, spend so much of their time asking rhetorically, does the world exist or does the world not exist? Because Achdas Hashem does not allow for a world to exist. Dire betachteinim, the kavana sabriye, teiro, mitzvahs, requires a world to exist. So which is it? Does it exist or does not exist? It's a very, very complicated question that goes to some extent around and around in a circle. This is what chassidim, who are concerned with understanding of what chassidus, are busy with working out how there could be achdas Hashem and at the same time there could be a kavana. And the maimor of Yisach Shtayim, lektim kishuin, and so on. We have a case. The same kind of thing here. Teva and Es, there's nature and the supernatural. Does nature exist? You can even argue, does the supernatural exist? Why? Everything is God. If everything is God, nature is God, the miracle is God, neither exist. In other words, when you call something nature, it's a lie. Because there's no such thing as nature, it's only Elikus. Moreover, when you call something a miracle, it's also a lie, because miracles, just like nature, don't have any existence other than the Metzias of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And yet we have the terms of Nes and Teva. We have the terms of miracle and supernatural. And we have the terms of Nes and Teva not only in common speech, in the language of man, Dibra, Teira, Kaloshev, and the other, but in Teira itself. Teira uses the delineations, the distinctions between Teva and Nes. So here's a maimer that asks the question, so what is Teva and what is Nes if Ein Eid Mulvade? And of course, the answer is basically the same as the one we gave earlier. Just like you have Yichud Eloah, which appeals to Das Elyon, and you have Yichud Tatoh, which appeals to Das Tachton. So Teva and Nes also appeal to these various different levels. When you use the word nature, you use the word miracle, in a world which is entirely governed by HaKadosh Baruch Hu, nature is a perspective, it's a level, it's a deah. And a miracle is a perspective, it's a level, it's a different deah. So there's credibility, there's truth to the term teva. There's credibility, there's truth to the term nes, in as much as those perspectives are concerned. But as this maimed unfolds, as this maimed deepens, the separation between the term teva and the term nes is going to become finer and finer. In other words, we're going to start out understanding teva and nes in a very simple way, that what separates them is deis, on what level and how you're knowing a lakus in relationship with the world. But as we go deeper into the mind, the difference between teva and nes is going to become much more edel, much more theoretical, much more mystical. And of course, we're going in a certain direction, like I told you before. We're going in the direction of establishing what we would call, even though this maimed doesn't use these words exactly, but this is the Teichen Advarim, Yichud, Das Elyon and Das Tachton, Yichud, Yichud Yilo and Yichud Tato. But before we get to that, we have to explore the terms Teva and explore the term Nes. So before we start to read, I know I've already spoken for 21 minutes almost, but I need to say plain words. What does nature mean? Nature means a series of laws that govern the world in a way that's patterned and predictable and limited. Right? What's nature? If you throw a rock up, it's going to land every time. If you pour water down a hill, it's going to go to the bottom of the hill every time. Nature has fixed laws that never change, that always respond to physical phenomena exactly the same way. And if you see something happen in nature and it doesn't make sense to you, you simply don't know all the facts. But if you figured out all the facts and you understood all the facts, you would see that nature is governed by very, very specific laws that, like I said before, they're constant and they're predictable and they're repetitive. And of course, the simple argument is that there's no room for the Eibishter in nature. Nature and the Eibishter are tarte desase. Why? The presence of Hashem means that everything that happens, He's doing. Nature means that there seems to be laws that govern what's happening in the Eibishter's world that seem to be self-contained and unbreakable and constant and consistent. If nature is following laws and those laws continue indefinitely with the perfect pattern and 100% consistency, it seems that the Eibishter is not involved. Nature just taking its course. In other words, Hashem created the laws. But once He created the laws, the world seems to be running away with itself within the parameters of nature. It's a such nature. So when you look at the world at a natural level, you don't see a lakus. To use the simple example, you plant seeds of wheat. Wheat is going to grow, not barley. Why? That's nature. Where's the Eibishter? The Eibishter is only here in the effect that He created the earth. He created the Keichat Semeach Shebaretz. He created this teva that when you put a seed in the ground, it rots and it produces from the earth, Kiyetze Be'a, crop which is similar to itself. And therefore, if you plant wheat, wheat will grow. If you plant barley, barley will grow, and so on. So in nature, as we understand it, in convention, there's no Eibishter directly. He's the creator of nature, but nature seems to have its own law and order, as opposed to a miracle. What's the meaning of a miracle? The meaning of the word miracle is nature is broken. And if the meaning of the word miracle is that nature is broken, you need a breaker. Someone had to have broken nature. So in the word miracle, there's a connotation of Hashem, the breaker of nature, which is HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Eibishter Himself. So before you get to any Mamari Hasidus, before you get involved in any scholarship and any philosophy, on a very, very simple level, nature means laws that the Eibishter may have prepared and written and designed. But as long as nature takes its course, you don't see the Yad Hashem at all. You see nature taking its course. And on a certain level, you could say there is no Yad Hashem. There is just the indirect Yad Hashem, which is responsible for nature taking its course and following its laws. And a miracle is a koyach eliki, which is breaking nature, intervening within nature, and changing nature. In other words, in a miracle, you see the Eibishter overtly, and in nature, you don't see the Eibishter overtly. In other words, in a miracle, Hashem is mixing in, and in nature, Hashem is leaving the world alone. This is a perspective on Teva and Nes. This is not a Teda perspective. It's not a Yiddish perspective. It's a worldly perspective. It's a philosophical perspective. If you look at the world as a believer in HaKadosh Baruch Hu, from the outside, you would conclude that nature seems to be going, taking its own course without the intervention of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And miracles is the Eibishter interfering. So this is how you understand that nature versus a miracle before you start learning a Maamar Chassidus. When you start learning a Maamar Chassidus, you obviously immediately encounter the fallacy of that idea. That when you say nature and a miracle, you're not talking about a system that the Eibishter is not involved with. versus a system that the Eibishter is involved with, but rather both of them are systems in which the Eibishter is involved, but he's involved in different ways. In other words, what I told you before was a simple understanding of a nature of nature, and of a miracle as it's understood, as it's construed in Amadabar, simple people, as they understand these things without any inspiration from Torah, and certainly any inspiration from Pnimiyas HaTorah. When you get to the Maimer, nature has the Eibishter in it. In other words, not Hashem created nature once upon a time, but every instance is recreating nature. So there's a Koyach HaLaki in nature itself. And of course, in a miracle, there's also a Koyach HaLaki, and in a much more revealed and an overt way. So our Maimer begins where common sense ends, if you will. Common sense ends, nature is Hashem having made laws that now run on their own, and in miracles Hashem intervening. The Maimer Chassidus is going to say, when it seems to you and me that nature seems to be the order of the day, and there's a pattern and a predictability and a constancy to how things flow in the Eibishter's world, the Eibishter is present within that system right here, right now, except that because of the nature of nature, you don't see the Eibishter. Mashenken in a nes, in a miracle, because of the nature of a miracle, it's clear that the Eibishter is doing it. But in reality, Hashem is found as much in Teva as he's found in nes. So let's put it in these words. The introduction to tonight's class is how we understand Teva and nes in Welt. How does the world understand Teva? Hashem is not involved. How does the world understand Nes? The Eibishter is intervening. And in Torah, in Teva the Eibishter is found, and in Nes the Eibishter is found, and in two different ways. And as we learn this Maimed, we learn tonight's class, we're going to learn two different ways on two different levels. In other words, if what I said to you earlier, the worldly perspective, the Teva is Hashem uninvolved, the Nes is Hashem yes involved, as opposed to the Torah perspective that Hashem is involved in Teva as well as in Nes, in this idea that Hashem is involved both in Teva as well as he's involved in Nes, in this itself we're going to have two levels, a lower level and a higher level. So in Peirik Gimel we're going to learn the lower level, and at the beginning of Peirik Dalet we're going to learn the higher level. So let's go to the text, and let's read the beginning of Peirik Gimel. I'm going to start four words into the Peirik, because this is where we're starting. In other words, what we're doing is we're starting the Maimon in the middle. The Aschola and the Siyum, we're going to leave for the third Shir, Beli Nedir, if everything goes to plan. But in the meantime, we're going to be doing a Shir on Teva and Nes, and then we're going to go deeper with Hashem in the next Shir. So the Rebbe says, the Sheir is a Teva Mishem Elikim. Where does Teva come from? The divine name Elikim. As we all know, that Elikim, which is 86, Aleph Lamed Hey Yud Mem is 86, is Begimatria Teva, the same numerical equivalent of HaTeva. HaTeva is also 86. While v'sheidish hanisim v'sheim avaya, the root of miracles is v'sheim avaya. So let's pause right here and make the point. When you say that Teva comes from v'sheim elokim, you don't only mean that Teva comes from v'sheim elokim because elokim is hiding the Eibishter. Because that's the pre-Torah perspective. When you say that Teva comes from v'sheim elokim, you mean to say there is a godliness called elokim. Like the Pasuk says, ochen ata kel mistater. There's the godliness of concealment. And the godliness of concealment doesn't mean a concealment over godliness, but how godliness itself is in a concealed state. And Teva comes from this, from the godliness of concealment, not godliness as it's concealed. And the Rebbe says, and it's explained, and Marei Chassidus, if you're looking in the footnotes, you see that this is based on a Maimon from the Rebbe Rashab and Ayin Ches, and a Maimon from the Friedrich Rebbe and Tzadik Ches. The Shem Havayu Das Elyon, a miracle which is connected to the divine name Havaya, where the godliness is revealed. This is Das Elyon. What's Das Elyon? That you're looking at the world from a level of Yehudi Allah that Ein Eid Mulvadi. Shalamai La Yesh. What is real? Hashem, the Eibishter. Ulamata Ayin. And the world is insignificant. Elokus is insignificant. Hainashakola is Havas. That all of creation, he Ayin, the Ephes, is insignificant and inconsequential. V'kula Kamei. And in the presence of Elokus, Kloch Shiv, it's nothing. So Shem Havaya is the Gili of Elokus. But it's the Gili of Elokus on such a level which says Das Elyon, that everything which is created from this Deyam, everything which is created from this Gili is a Gili of Elokus. In other words, if Hashem creates a world, but when you look at the world, you see the proactive hand of Hashem, the world is nothing other than an expression of Him. There's no world, there's a Gili of the Eibishter in the Tzir of a world. And that's the Taich, Ayin ve'Efes, and Kloch Shiv. As opposed to Shem Elokim, the divine, Em Elokim, which is the godliness of concealment, is Das Tach, it's a lower Deah. And what's the lower Deah? The lower Deah is there is a world, and Hashem is its master. Shabri, Emi Ayin LeYesh. That the way we perceive Das Tachten is that the world is a Yesh. Down here there's Yesh, there's reality. And above us there's Ayin. And as we translated in the last two Maimorim, Ayin means the unknown. What's true and what's real is creation. It's a form that has an independence. And while the divine energy which is sustaining this yesh, nikri b'shem ayin, is called ayin, and in this case, the meaning of the word ayin is not that it's inconsequential. Faket, it's more important than the yesh which it creates, but rather the meaning of the word ayin is she'enei musa, we cannot understand it. So nes, which comes from shem havaya, is linked to das elyon, which says it is nothing other than the Eibishter. Teva, which is linked to shem elokim, is linked to das tachem, says there is a world, and Hashem is a balabos. Das Elyon doesn't say there is a world of which Hashem masters. Das Elyon says there is an expression of Hashem. Das Tachin says there is a world of which Hashem masters, and the Rebbe now adds to this scheme the word Teva and the word Elokim, and the word Nes and the word Havaya. V'yashleim, I said the Rebbe, I want to continue further and make this point. What is the reason of how do we understand that from the perspective of Havaya or Nes, is Das Elyon from the perspective of Lekim, or Tevaj Das Tacht. Says the Rebbe, the Pshat is as follows. This is explained in other Mamari Chasidus. And Derech Agav, we had this shtickle also in one of the Mamari we learned last year. God Liya covered the bias, Achim Narishain. This Hav was Shemeshem Elokim, when the Eibishter creates the world, using the divine name Elokim. It's not only that Hashem creates in a way where he conceals, but there's another factor. That is Bederech Islapshus. Hashem creates the world by hiding himself in the world. But Hashem creates the world by hiding himself in the world, but investing himself. He puts himself into the world in a concealed state. As the Pasuk says, Bereishis Bara Lekim. The creation which comes from Shem Lekim is Bara. Bara means created proactively. The Zem made Shumok Elinais Havos. When the Eibishter creates the world with Shem Lekim, he creates it proactively, on purpose, directly. All of this leads to say that a Lekim, which is creating the world, is invested in the world, and therefore it's creating the world in such a way that the world is a Metzias. And therefore continues the Rebbe, and he says, when a Lekim creates the world. And of course, a Lekim creates the world, but that Bora, in a proactive and in a slapshus like fashion. Have some reckoning, have some value in the presence of the name of the Eibishter, which is Elokim. And therefore, v'abitl shalahem, the bitl of the world, is rak abitl ayesh, it's a bitl of ego. Das tachten, which the lower day, which says shalamat ayesh, we exist independently, but we're only bitl to the Eibishter and no more. So bereishis bara Elokim has two components that are important. Number one, Elokim, and number two, bara. The word Elokim connotes that Hashem is using a koyach of helem to create. And bara means that Hashem is using koyach of helem to create in an invested and a proactive and in a slapshus way. And because of these two ideas, Elokim, which is concealment, and bara, which is a proactive and an invested way, both of these concepts add up to a world that has a chashivas. The world is important because Hashem is hidden and Hashem is investing himself in the world for the world's sake. On the other hand, Vaisav was Shem Shem Avaya. There is also creation from Shem Avaya. And how does Avaya create? Avaya creates by will. Elokim creates with Erech Islapshus. He goes in to create the world. And Avaya creates the world from will alone. It says the Rebbe, Be'evin de Bederech Mamela, it's automatically says in the post, Gal Shem Avaya, Ki Yitziva Vinivro. And here again, you have two key words. The first word is Avaya as opposed to Elokim, and the second word is Vinivro as opposed to Bora. The difference in Elokim and Havaya we all understand. Elokim means the godliness, it's the godliness of concealment. Havaya means the godliness of revelation. But the other difference is Bara means Hashem is creating proactively in a way of investing himself, and Nivinivro means the world is happening almost by itself. Shazem Meire, which indicates Shumu, Flaminyanis Havas, that the Havaya, that the Keyech Eloki, which is responsible in the creation of the world, is not invested in the worlds. And accordingly, whatever is created from Shem Havaya, since Havaya creates in a way of separation, the worlds that it creates have no value in relationship with the Shem Havaya. This is called Bitl B'Metzias Das Elyon Shalamata Ayin. When the Eibush creates with a Lakim, it's called Bara. When the Eibush creates a Havaya, it's called Vinivro. That means the Eibush creates a Lakim, he creates in such a way where the world is his issue. And when the Eibush creates a world of Hashem Havaya, he creates in such a way where the issue is his will. So the world is a byproduct of his will, and there's no yeshus to the world whatsoever. And this is the difference between Teva in Nes, in the language of Teir, in the language of Kabbalah. Not Chas V'Shalom, the Eibush that is not in Teva. And the Eibush that is in Nes, Hashem is in Teva. Hashem is in Nes, but Hashem is in Teva in a way of a Lakim. And Hashem is in Teva in a way of Islapshu, so the world has a Chshivas. Hashem is in Nes in a way of Avaya. Hashem is in Nes in a way of Maivir, or how does he put it? Muflam in Yenayisavos, and therefore the worlds are bottle. So the Rebbe continues in the next paragraph and explains what we just said more. Umavu, Erba, Drushim, Amarim continue to explain what would be the difference between Teva, which is created from Shem Elikim, Bederach Bodo, which is Islapshus, and Nes, which is created from Shem Avaya, Bederach Vinivro, which is not Bederach Islapshus. The Kmei, Shobinyin Hashem, is we just discussed the two names of the Eibishter, and we linked into Das Tachna, Das Elyon, the B'Shem, Havaya, Das Elyon, the divine name. Havaya is the higher Deo, which means all there is the Eibush of the world, there's no Metzias. And Shem, Elikim, Das Tachna, the lower name of the Eibush, Elikim, is Das Tachna. Das Tachna says there is a world, which the Eibush masters. Alderech Zogam, B'Yin, Esveteva. Just like Havaya and Elikim are Das Tachna, Das Elyon, Nes and Teva are also Das Elyon and Das Tachna. Because since Hanim Shochem, Havaya and Elikim, a miracle and nature come from Havaya and Elikim respectively, so just like Havaya and Elikim are Das Elyon and Das Tachton, Nes and Teva are Das Elyon and Das Tachton. Then, oh, Gaza Tevi mitzah Das Tachton, the way nature takes its flow, conduct is from Das Tachton. Das Tachton means you know the world as a Metzias, which is battle to the Yebishtim. As opposed to Vahanisim, miracles, Shalomailim Yatevi, which are higher than nature, is Mebchin as Das Elyon, the higher Dea, where everything is the Yebishtim, and as a consequent, Teva has no Metzias. V'yashleim, as says the Rebbe, I want to qualify this further. Shashayich is the Nes v'Teva. When we link Nes and Teva to Avaya and Elikim, and then to Das Tachna and Das Elyon, it's Leirach Mitzat Shorshim. You don't only mean that Teva comes from Das Tachna, and Nes comes from Das Elyon, Shashayich Shanisim is Mi'Avaya, Shashayich Shateva Mi'Alakus, but much more than that. Elaga, moreover, Mitzat Ha'inyin Dines v'Teva Atzmam. The way a miracle exists comes from Shem Avaya and Bederach Mamela. The way Teva exists comes from Shem Elikim and Bederach Islapshus. V'ha'in yinu depshat is anhog as a Teva he, what is nature? Shakadosh Baruch Hu Manach has called Nivra Lefi and Yoneh. Hashem governs you based on what you are. The Zem made it, which automatically shows the anhogazu in this form and level of governance and intervention, hanivroyim teif simakim, the worlds are of significance, even to the Eibush Kfayachol. In other words, lamata yesh, the yesh that's down here is important. On the other hand, v'nogas hanisasi, when the Eibush performs a miracle or governs his world in a supernatural way, itchagodesh baruch hamanaka se'elam kafir etzeina, Hashem is governing the world not based on what the world is, but based on what he wants. V'loik fi tchunas v'teva nevroim, not based on the character and the nature of the creation. Of course, you could right away interject, and you'd be right if you did so. The teva itself is ratzon elyon. And later on in this maimed, that statement is going to become most important. But the pashtus, ratzon elyon means the will of Hashem, which doesn't care about the world. As opposed to teva, where the Eibush is beslapshus in the world, is concerned with the world on a worldly level. Kiban Hog is the one the level of miracles, Hanivrayiminim Tefse Mokum, the creations. Have no Tfisa Smokum Lamata Ayin. And I'm stopping right here. I'm not reading the last 2.5 lines, because the next 2.5 lines address the issue of Yichud Das Talyan, Das Tachin, Das Elyon, Yichud L'Chud Ato, as I mentioned in my introduction. So this page said the same thing in a number of different ways. The essence of what this page is saying is that both Nes and Teva come from Elokus and Ar Elokus. But Teva comes from Elikus and is Elikus inside the way where Elikus is concerned with there being a world. And Nes is created by Elikus, but created by Elikus in such a way where Elikus is concerned that its will should be satisfied, what the Eibishter wants should be satisfied. So if we were to stop right here, what would be the difference between the first explanation that I gave you, which is, so to speak, pre-Maimed, and the second explanation I gave, which we just read in Siv Gimel? In the pre-Maimer, that in my introduction, you would say, Teva, the Eibush is not involved in. And Es Hashem is involved. But we read in Siv Gimel saying, Hashem is involved in Teva, Hashem is involved in Nes, but in different ways. Hashem is involved in Teva, but Teva dictates what Hashem wants. Hashem is involved in Nes, and Hashem dictates what a Nes is going to be. So the first Oifen, so to speak, leaves the Eibishter out of Teva, leaves him only in Nes. And the second Oifen leaves the Eibishter both in Teva as well as in Nes. But in this Oifen, in Teva, there's Das Tachten. It's about the Eibishter serving the world. And the world expresses him on a worldly level. And Nes is where the world serves the Eibishter's will. So in the second Oifen, both Teva and Nes are expressions of Elokus, but expressions of Elokus on two different levels. Now we go to Perek Dalet, top of page Mem Aleph, and we read a third pshat in Teva and Nes, a totally different pshat. And the difference between this third pshat that we're about to have and the second pshat that we just had is probably more distinct than the difference between the second pshat, which is a teda pshat, and the first pshat, which is a pre-teda pshat. Let's go. Omavur ba'adrushim. My modem says something different. And it's categorically, it's classically different than we said until now. What are we saying now? The shtei adeis em emes. Das tachna das elyin. Yechudato yechud elo. Elokim en avaye. Teva and es are both emes. Why? So, in the last two my modem, the reason shtei em emes is because das tachna is also deis avaye. Das tachna is a perspective. Here the Rebbe says something much, much edler. The shteyim yesh lahem shedish biatzmas erinzav. When you say teva or das tachten, yichud tato is emes, it's not because the Eibishter is hidden in it, but because there's a place called erinzav. There's a place called atzmas erinzav. And the perspective of teva and elakim and das tachten is rooted in atzmas erinzav. Similarly, the level of Avaya and Nes and Yichud Elo and Das Elyon also has a place in Ein Sof. So now you have a new idea. Teva is not one expression of Elokus and Nes is a different expression of Elokus. But both Teva and Nes are expressions of Ein Sof on the level of Atzmos, which is a much higher inyan than what we just discussed. And he explains. When you talk about godliness, there's two ideas. Now, of course, this is a philosophical concept. It's based on the Tikkun Ezeyar, and as you know, probably you'll see it in a moment. The Basi Lagani Tovshin Yud, a considerable number of prokim beginning with Perek Yud Beis, is going to explain the Tikkun Ezeyar we're about to learn. And the point is, there's not two levels of Ein Sof. There's not two aspects of Ein Sof. But every point in Ein Sof is simultaneously two in Yonim. What are the two in Yonim? It says the Rebbe Shula Maila Maila Adin Ketz Veshula Mata Mata Adin Tachlis. The two ideas in Ein Sof is the concept that Ein Sof is higher and higher beyond an end, and that Ein Sof is lower and lower beyond the purpose. And it says Takin Debasi Legani, like it's going to explain here. And by the way, in Samachov it says Faked that Lamaila Maila Adin Ketz means that no matter how much you know about the Eibishter, you don't know anything about him because he's hidden. And Lamata Mata Adin Tachlis means that no matter how much godliness is concealed, you could see the Eibishter. This is how it's explained in Basi Lagani. I'll repeat that again. Lamaila Maila Adin Ketz means as much as you think you understand the Lakus, you don't understand anything. And Lamata Mata Adin Tachlis means as much as you think a Lakus is hidden in the worlds of Klipa, a Lakus is revealed. So the Rebbe now says, Ushnein Yarim El, these two mystical concepts. The concept of Lamaila Maila Adin Ketz means that no matter what you know nothing. And Lamata Mata in Tachas, no matter how much you want to hide the Eibishter's revealing, is a Shedish, the Das Tachten, the Das Elyon. The two Deis, the Das that says there is a world that Hashem governs, and the Das that says there is Hashem that's expressed in a world and nothing more than that, those two Deis are represented by the two perspectives on the same concept. Ein Ein Sof is one. Atzma Sof Ein Ein Sof is one. But Atzma Sof Ein Sof has the idea of Lamaila Adin Ketz and Lamata Adin Tachas. And he says, Shemitzada Gil de Ein Sof. Ein Sof is a faculty, it's a property of Gilui. And of course, when Ein Sof is revealed, it's revealed everywhere. It's revealed everywhere equally. Shuba Gili Bechom Mokam is revealed everywhere. This is called Lamata Mata Adin Tachlis. It descends lower and lower beyond the purpose. This is the idea that godliness is revealed everywhere. And inasmuch as Lamata Mata Adin Tachlis is concerned, which means godliness is revealed everywhere, Kuluk Meklach Shiv Das Elyon Lamata Ayin. So in this maimed, Lamata Mata Adin Tachlis doesn't mean Hela, means Gile, how Hashem is revealed in the lowest words in such a high madrega that Ein Eid Muvad. On the other hand, lemaila maila din ketz is called mitat ha'helem de'ir ein sof. Then de'ir ein sof is the power of concealing. Shumis ale ba'atzmusei, that godliness, no matter how hard we try to know him, is an unknown, because he's uplifted in a level of being atzmus, that means existing in relationship with himself, which is lemaila maila din ketz. As a consequence of this, hanevraim be'metzias yesh, since there is an aspect of ein sof, where Hashem is hidden away and nobody knows him, what's left down here is Yeshus, das tachten shalamata yesh. So the Rebbe says, teva and nes are not mushish in two inyonim, like avaya and elikim. Teva and nes are mushish in two aspects of one and the same inyon, which is Ein Sof, or atzmus Ein Sof. The reason there's a teva is because there's a concept of atzmus Ein Sof to hide. And since there's a concept of atzmus Ein Sof to hide, the world is left over. And there's a concept of Atzmus of Ein Sof to be revealed. And since there is a concept in Atzmus of Ein Sof to be revealed, the world has no Metzias whatsoever. So how is this different than the Pshat that we had before? Huh? How is what I just said different than the Pshat we had before? The difference is a Pshat Tezach. The obvious difference is that in the Pshat we had in Sif Gimel, Teva comes from one thing and Nes comes from something else. Elikim comes from one thing, Havaya comes something else, and here both will come from the same idea, Ein Sof. But there's another difference. That when you go in this third eifin of separating Teva from Nes, Teva is as much an expression of Ein Sof as Nes is. Teva is an expression of Ein Sof, and Nes is an expression of Ein Sof. The difference is, Teva is an expression of Ein Sof, where Ein Sof is hiding. Hein Hing Vureis. And Nes is an expression of Ein Sof, where Elikus is revealed. There's a whole new pshat in understanding Nes and Teva. Now, I want to remind you how I explained it to you in the beginning. The foundation of this discussion is the question that since Ein Eid Mulvadei, nothing is real. Nevertheless, we speak about two deis, because even though ultimately nothing is real, but in Teda itself, there's a Das Tachna and there's a Das Elyon. So when the previous Peirik, we understood the Das Tachna Das Elyon to be two shemes, and two ways of creation, and two madregas of das, and two madregas of yichud, and so on. Now all of those things become two expressions of one and the same thing, Ein Sof. If we're talking about the concealing aspect of Ein Sof, Teva emerges, and the world is a metzias, because the metzias of the world says, Ein Sof lamayla din ketz. In other words, when you look at Teva, you don't see the Eibishter. What are you seeing? You're saying the Eibishter's infinite ability to hide himself. You don't see Teva. You see the koyach ha-helem of the Eibishter. And when you look at the world and you see only godliness, that's lamata mata din tachas. Let me say that again. I want to say, repeat the same words again. When you look at nature and you don't see the Eibishter, you're seeing the Eibishter's concealing power. So the nature and the world is the elikus of helem. When you look at nature and you don't see nature, you see only Elikus, this is the Elikus of Gilui. So there's a huge difference between the Pshat of Peirik Gimel and the Pshat of Peirik Daled. And again, I want to enrich this by sort of having three things. The first is not an Amayim, this is in Amad Abad, in the world, where you say in Teva there's no intervention of the Eibishter, in the Nest there is. But in this Maimed, of course, just like the Eibishter is in Nest, the Eibishter is in Teva as well. The difference is that in Teva it's Elikim, in Teva it's Islapshus, in Teva it's Das Tachten. And in Nes it's Havaya, and in Nes it's Memela, and Nes is Das Elyon. And now we're saying Teva and Nes, Havaya and Elikim, Das Tachin Das Elyon are all in one thing, Ein Sof, Atzmus of Ein Sof. The Koyach HaHelem of Atzmus of Ein Sof is the basis for Teva and Das Tachin and Elikim and Islapshus. And the Koyach HaGili of Ein Sof is the basis for Nes and Havaya and Memela and so on. Okay, now I want you to skip all the way until Sif Yud, the very bottom of page Memhe. Okay? And the Rebbe is going to now point out the difference between the Pshat of Das Tachna Das Elyon, Teva of, and Nes, in Peirik Gimel of our Maimer, and the Pshat of Das Tachna Das Elyon, Teva and Nes, in the first paragraph of Peirik Daled in the Maimer. The Rebbe says like this. That beklolus, a few words into Sif Yud, yeah, beklolus ha'inyin didas tachten. When we speak about the lower perspective, and the lower perspective at first says, there is a world and Hashem is the balabas in a state of hiddenness. Yesh bei shnei yefanim. We have two ways of understanding it. Number one, the way we understood it in Peirik Gimel, the first way. Sha'deya shalamata yesh hu. The reason there is a deya that says that down here there is a yesh. Lefisha legabe dar yezu. The level of das tachten says hamata mitzad atzmi hu mitzias. The world is in existence. And va'bitl shalayu rak bitl yesh. The first understanding of das tachten, bitl yesh, says I exist and I'm bottled. As opposed to what we learned just now in the beginning of Perek Dalet, where we said that Teve and Nes are both connected to the very same idea, Atzmas Ein Sof, or Ein Sof. And the whole Chilik is where there's the Madreg of Lamayla Din Kes Lamata Din Tachlis, says Derev Vashdeya, there's another approach, Shalamata Yesh, that the only reason down here there is a Yesh is Bechdei Sheyihi a Giloy, because the Yeshus of this world is a Giloy of Ha'inyin de Lamayla Mayla Din Kes. Tap the page, Mem Vavna. So one Eifin is saying Teva is the Eibishter in a concealed state. And the other Eifin is saying is Teva is the revelation of the Eibishter in his concealment. The godliness of concealment. So look at page Mavav now. When you want to separate what we learned in Perek Gimel of the Maimer and what we learned in Perek Dalet of the Maimer, that Perek Gimel of the Maimer also says that the Eibishter is in Teva. But Perek Gimel says that the Eibishter is in Teva in such a way where he's serving Teva. And Teva is the Iker. Masha'enkein in Perek Dalet, Hashem is not serving Teva. Teva is serving Hashem's Keiach HaHel. Says the Rebbe like this, the Be'eif in Ha'alef, the way we understood Teva in Nes and Perek Gimel, and in Perek Gimel we understood, Shamata mitadat mitzias, the world is a mitzias. It's only that the Eibish is the Balabos, Kum tois, the Das Tachten and Das El, Yenem Shtei Deis Hofchim. The lower Deya, which is the Eibishter serving the world, and the higher Deya, which is the world expressing the Eibishter, are opposites. Be'etzem husam, all the way to the very essence. Why? Das tachten hu, the lower Deya is shamata hu yesh, that the world is real, and the Eibishter is the servant of the world. Kvayachol. And das elyon hu shamata hu ay, and das elyon is that the Eibishter is the only real Metzias, and the world is an expression of the Eibishter. So in Perek Gimel, even though in Perek Gimel, das tachten, as well as Das Elyon HaRelakus, not like that we understood it outside of the Maimir, but in Das Tachten, in Perek Gimel, Elakus is serving the world, it's lapshus. And Das Elyon, the world is serving Elakus. Says the Rebbe, however, Beifen HaBeis in the second way, Shadeya Shalamata Yesh, the reason the Eibishter created a perspective where the world is a Metzias, it's only Botlin a Bitla Yesh, is not because godliness is serving worldliness, but the Eibishter wants to reveal the two aspects of the Atzmus of Ein Sof. And one of the aspects of the Atzmus of Ein Sof is the infinite power of Hashem's Keiach HaHelem of the Eibishter concealing himself. So when you look at Teva, what are you seeing? The revelation of the godly power of concealment. And accordingly, look at the next words. Ha'ofchi es d'shtei adei es hu. When you say it is das tachten and das elyon. When you say this, Yichud is a Torah and Yichud is Allah. When you say this, Elokim and Havai. When you say this, Teva and Nes. You know how the difference is Rak Batzia Shalem. How they present it. Teva is presenting Eibishter. Nes is presenting Eibishter. Elokim is presenting Eibishter. Havai is presenting Eibishter. Das Tachlis is presenting Eibishter. Das Salim is presenting Eibishter. Yichud is presenting Eibishter. Yichud is presenting Eibishter. What's the presentation? In Teva and in Elokim and Das Tachlis and Yichud is a Torah, you're presenting the Eibishter's ability to hide. And in Nes, and in Havaye, and Das Tach, Das Elyon, and Yichud Allah, it's the Eibishter's ability to reveal himself. They're one of the same thing. The Inyonem Shal Shtei Adeyes Hu, the concepts, the spirit of both days is Gili Inyonem Shebe Ein Sof. There's one thing called Ein Sof. And this thing Ein Sof is the Keiach HaHelem, which is represented by Teva. And the Keiach HaGilu was presented by Nes. Elasha, Das Elyon Hu HaGil De Lamata Adin Tachlis. Das Elyon expresses the revelation aspect of the Ein Sof. And Das Tachnis HaGilui De Lamayla Adin Ketz. And Das Tachnis expressing the power of concealment of the Eibishter. Look at the next words. Vezehu Shegam Das Tachnu Emes. That's the Pshat. And the Rebbe said in the first words of Perek Dalet that Das Tachnis Emes. What's the Pshat Das Tachnis Emes? Das Tachten Emes doesn't mean that the Eibishter created Das Tachten. Das Tachten is Emes means Das Tachten tells you as much about the Eibishter as Das Elyon does. When you look at the world and you don't see the Eibishter, you're seeing a revelation of the Eibishter, Keiach HaHelem, and that's an Emes thing. So to summarize what we learned tonight, we learned very little Kamus, if you will. We learned Sif Gimel, and we didn't read the last couple of lines. We learned the first paragraph of Sif Dalet, but didn't read the second paragraph. And for the most part, we learned Perek Yud. That's more or less what we did. The way I presented it to you, you have Teva and Nes before Teira, so to speak, where the Eibush is not involved in Teva, he is involved in Nes. You have Teva and Nes as they're in Teira, where the Eibush is involved in Teva, and the Eibush is involved in Nes. But in Teva, the Eibush, so to speak, is serving Teva. And in Nes, the world is serving the Eibush. And the third pshat, the Teva and Nas, are both expressions of the Ein Sof. Now, why is all of this so important? You'll see in the next shiur. But keep in mind where we're going with this. This introduction of this new concept of Das Tachne and Das Elyon, that they're not two levels. The two expressions of saying Ein Sof is going to set up the point of our Maimir, which is Yichud, Yichud HaDaton, Yichud HaLo, which we'll see in Mitzvah Hashem in the third shiur.